Hello friends, welcome to Research Life. I am your host, Dr. Sabyasachi Sengupta, founder and director of Sengupta's Research Academy and practicing vitreoretinal surgeon in Mumbai. Research Life is a platform meant to ignite the spirit of clinical research amongst all of us. Here I host some of the most eminent researchers in India, and I'm confident that their journey will inspire us all. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce today's guest on the show, Dr. Virendra Sangwan. Dr. Sangwan is a renowned ophthalmic surgeon of international repute with over 25 years of rich clinical experience under his belt. He has been involved with cutting-edge research in eye care, and his major contribution has been in the field of translational research in ophthalmology involving limbal stem cells. He has mastered the technique of cultivation of stem cells for treatment of corneal blindness and has treated over 800 patients, which represents the largest human application of adult stem cells anywhere in the world. He has developed a cost-effective technique of growing stem cells on patient's eye, which is called the SLET, or the Simple Limbal Epithelial Transplantation. During his career, Dr. Sangwan has been longest associated with the L.V. Prasad Eye Institute in Hyderabad from the years 1998 to 2018, where he has worked as the director of the Center for Ocular Regeneration, or CORE, and the Srujana Center of Innovations. He has also been associated with the Department of Ophthalmology at the Harvard Medical School and with the DC-10 Flying Eye Hospital of Orbis International earlier in his career. Currently, he is the Director Innovations at the Dr. Shroff Charity Eye Hospital, Daryaganj, New Delhi. He did his fellowship in immunology and uveitis from the Harvard Medical School, Boston, and the Massachusetts Eye and Ear Infirmary Department of Ophthalmology from July 1996 to January 1998. He has more than 550 presentations, more than 250 publications in peer-reviewed index journals, and 15 books and book chapters to his credit. He is the section editor of the British Journal of Ophthalmology and has been the associate editor of the Indian Journal of Ophthalmology from 2000 to 2006. He has been conferred more than 20 recognition awards for personal and joint contribution in the field of ophthalmology from national as well as international agencies, the significant ones being the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in 2006 conferred by the CSIR Government of India for work in stem cell transplantation. He was a co-recipient of the National Technology Award in 2007 for limbal stem cell work and for initiating the first adult stem cell therapy in India. The award was presented by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, the then President of India. So without further ado, I present to you Dr. Virendra Sangwan. Welcome to the show, sir.
First of all, thank you so much for agreeing to do this with me, and I'm sure it's going to be fascinating and a lot of people will learn a lot of different things from so many things that you have done. We are all looking forward very eagerly.
It's my pleasure.
So the first question was, how did your clinical research journey begin and what motivated you?
I think the motivation was purely clinical challenges, and the first paper I think I wrote was when I was a fellow with Dr. Rao, Jain Rao, in cornea and anterior segment at L.V. Prasad Institute. And before that also in PG, actually, I did publish a small paper in North Zone Ophthalmic Society Journal, which was related to something very trivial called concretions, which we see in the lids. So the chemical analysis of that. Started when I was doing my research fellowship at Harvard Medical School with Dr. Stephen Foster. And that the research fellowship was an interest to enhance my clinical skills and clinical effectiveness. And everybody at that time told me it's a very stupid idea to do a research fellowship that sue in ocular inflammation. Why don't you do refractive surgery? Why don't you do IULs? What is the point doing uveitis or ocular inflammation?
So the next question that we wanted to pose is, did you have a mentor or someone you looked up to when you were
not particular for research, but in general, I think Dr. Rao was someone, a very tall figure whom we got very impressed when we were doing fellowship. And then, and he has been a role model all along for everything. Not only clinical research or writing or as a clinician, as a leader, as a surgeon, teacher. And the second one was Dr. Stephen Foster, because I spent a quite significant time, 2 years of research fellowship with him.
Right, sir. I'm sure.
And he is also very accomplished clinician, scientist, and very, world authority on in that area of ocular inflammation.
So I'm sure would have been motivation enough to go on your journey. Then the third question was, when did you publish your first paper? Tell us a little bit more about that.
First paper, I think the peer-reviewed journal, I think it was in when I was a fellow with Dr. Rao, and it was related to the treatment of treatment outcome of corneal perforations using tissue adhesive and bandage contact lens. Mm-hmm. So my role was essentially to collect the data and then review the literature, and I did all those things, and then I had joined Orbis, the Flying Eye Hospital. And then I think it was finished, paper was finished by Vinay Agarwal, who followed me in fellowship.
Then the next question was, how important to start early in life, maybe during MBBS or at least during residency? Do you think it's okay to start late?
Well, I don't think it's okay to start late, because when you start late, everything you do late, or you don't have much time. But I would certainly encourage people who want to do clinical research or research per se, start thinking early in the medical college itself. In our most of our medical colleges, we really don't have any exposure or any idea what the research is. And same is during the residency. Mostly medical students, English is also not very good. Hmm. English writing, written English.
So starting early is the mantra, I think. All of us would agree.
Yes. See, for me, all odds were staked against me. And I really did not think about those things. I grew up in a small village in Haryana. I learned English when I was like after fifth standard, in sixth standard. So you are already 12, 13 years old. And then the kind of medical school I went, or most medical school anyway, don't have a exposure to research. Similarly, in the residency. Fellowship, we didn't really have a training in research, but yes, there was some semblance. We started reading papers. There were journal club presentations, very intense. And so literature review was very, very important during that time.
The next question was, how important is it, do you think, to publish a thesis?
See, nowadays, I think the at least what I see, thesis done in LVP or the institutions are very high quality. And publishing should be the top priority. In medical colleges, I don't know, at my during my time, the thesis was not done properly. And it was more of a cut-paste, very low quality work. And I ended up doing the thesis genuinely and actually did the research. And most people told me that this is not how thesis is done. You should just take readings and make it up, and cut and paste, and they should be nearby by somebody else who has done, so that nobody questions, which I didn't like. But I did the thesis myself along with my co-guide, but that was never published because the data were so way off, and I refused to change despite my guide saying that no, you should do. I said no, this is what it is, and I do not want to fuzz the data. I do not want to cover or make it up.
Right, sir. That is, I think, that's a great message already being sent out to so many.
Yeah, it's very important. Very important to be ethical, honest, and have integrity. Otherwise, very easy to slip to in the race to have publications. You fuzz or make up data. I think that's not a very good way. It reflects very poorly on yourself, the country, and the field.
Right, sir. So the next question was, do you think it is important to have formal training in clinical research methodology before you begin, or is it okay to start learning as you go along?
See, individuals depends on individuals. Most people want some sort of formal training, and yes, if you have something, it will be very helpful. I did not have a formal training. I did not have any training. I just mostly self-reading and self-learning on the job as I moved on. And so I did not have the opportunity of learning from anyone. But I did some online courses, self-learning essentially.
But you would recommend that if possible, it's better to...
Absolutely. I mean, if you have an option of learning, and if there's something online course which you can do at your own pace, and you know, that's fantastic. Then you don't have to disrupt your life, and you can get on with it and have some mentors who are willing to help you, guide you, or interact. That also becomes another channel.
Then the next question was, how important do you think an international stint is to develop your clinical and research skills?
See, international stint essentially helps you to develop a different perspective, to see the problem from a different angle and a different system, and also gives you more confidence when you come back. And unfortunately, your peer respect you more if you have come from outside. That's a part. It definitely is very helpful, because it gives you a totally different professional perspective.
Right, sir. The next question was, in your opinion, what should be our approach to biostatistics? It is a feared topic. So how do you approach it, and how do you convey your ideas to a statistician?
See, many people think that research means biostatistics or statistics. I don't think that should be the goal. The statistics is a specialized subject, and essentially makes you understand the impact of chance on your results. That's all about it. Whatever the test, whatever you are doing, calculations, that is what it helps you. So if you are someone who likes to understand, yes, you by all means, now you have so many ways and means, you should. Otherwise, leave it to a specialist, and you do your job and communicate in very clear terms what is that you are expecting out of the data. Most people feel that, okay, research means you should know statistics well. And then if you have some data, just give it to statistician. He will give you something out of it, and then you write. That should not be the approach. The approach should be, you are the one who tells the statistician, this is, as a clinician, I think the data is, and this what I think is coming out. Does that holds true if you analyze statistically? And how, then he will tell you, he will ask you questions so that he can give you a proper analysis.
Right. So there is nothing to be really afraid about, the whole.
Not at all. Not at all. I don't think it's just like, you know, it's a language. If I speak to meet some Maharashtrian, doesn't mean I should get feeling intimidated by his Maharashtrian language. It's just right. Another language.
Right, sir. Right, sir. So it's a very simplified way of putting it across, I think. Right, sir. Then the next question was, how did you get so many research ideas, one after another? So many new innovations and research ideas. I mean, we would like to know how your mind works and how you get these ideas.
See, I think this will work if you are genuinely interested in solving the problem what you are seeing, and not only be limited and controlled by the paradigm you have read in books or heard from someone, or, you know, your mentor told or your guide told something. So you can, if you remain within those boundaries, then you cannot think of. If you keep your patient as a focus, and what you are, believe your eyes, trust your brain, if I'm seeing something, even if it's not written in the books, you know that what I'm seeing is true, does not mean it has to be described by someone else. So always being aware that the diseases manifestation we see in patients is far more varied than what we read in books, because the books and journals represent a very small sample of what is seen clinically, because very few people write, and most people repeat what is already written. It's just like, you know, your brain gives you ideas which you already know. It's very difficult for the brain to give you ideas which you don't know. So similarly, if you are seeing some diseases, and if you don't pay attention what you are seeing, then obviously you'll not get ideas. And then you'll say, oh, this is not according to the book, or this is not according to the journal. Which I find is most people are just limited by what they have read or what they have seen before.
So essentially the message is, keep an open mind and large horizons.
Yes, absolutely. Widen. Horizons, and be open on what you are seeing. And right. If you may not know everything. You don't know everything. If you see something new, look up, take a photo, find out. Sometimes it may be just a very good clinical finding, but captured very nicely, that becomes a photo essay. It can become a cover page.
Right, sir. Right, sir. So, yeah, some great messages there. The next question was, What is the key to your manuscript preparation? We've all seen them to be very immaculate. So is there a particular order that you start with manuscripts?
No, not really. My way of thinking is that I am more of a doer, and meaning I do the work or generate the idea or get the material, and then writing part I help someone younger or someone in my team, or if I am doing it, I will organize literature review. Those things are already there, or I must prepare results, methods, all those things are getting ready, and discussion points I keep writing. And as I used to do is I also read quite a good number of books on scientific writing when I started writing. I also read books on English writing. So it's very important, these two elements. So doctors should focus more on communication part than these statistics. Statistics is only for people who are extremely interested in that, and it comes naturally to them. Otherwise, they should focus on writing properly and communicating the idea in a very simple way.
Right. Simplicity is much easier said than done, really. You have to...
Yes. No, that will happen only if your mind, if you are able to visualize and think simply, then your language also be simple. If your mind is complicated and thinks very in a circuitous way, then your language will be very verbose. You write very complex sentences, you write complicated language, you'll find difficult words. You think that if you use difficult words, people will get impressed. No, that's not. Writing in a very clear, simple way, conveying the idea, that is much more helpful.
Right, sir. The next question was, is there any particular paper or group of papers which have been your favorite or your most impactful work? Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
I think there are so many. To pick up one might be difficult. But yes, one I would say it may not be a very big paper, but it was in 2004 or 2005 when we started started diagnosing limbal stem cell deficiency in VKC. So in one patient I did a limbal allograft, cultivated limbal allograft, and with immunosuppressant. Another patient didn't want that, so I did only amniotic membrane. After 1 year or 6 months, the AMG patient failed, and over a period of 5 years became the same as before surgery. So I wrote up as a case series in cornea journal, and it was so difficult for them to accept that an Indian is describing a new entity in VKC. So it went to different journals, this, that, and finally one of the reviewers in cornea said, I suggest you don't name it as limbal stem cell deficiency in VKC, use a severe OSD in VKC, because people have difficulty in accepting as a limbal stem cell deficiency. So because that paper taught so many things, I feel that was very important. Similarly, the simple limbal epithelial transplantation paper in BJO, even though it was a series of 5 patients, but that created a much bigger impact.
Right.
There are many, because if you look at my publication, I'm very collaborative. I have so many co-authors from different walks of life, different countries, different cities. And I think working collaboratively is far more important than working alone and being first author all the time. My idea has been to develop authors and scientists rather than glorifying myself.
Right, sir. Again, a very important message there. The next question was, anything particular that you're working on right now that you would like to share with everyone?
Right now, I'm not writing anything actively, but these review articles and these things keep happening. And since I have moved out of LVP for last year and a half, so because I'm in a transition, so my productivity has not been in writing, that has not been that great because of other commitments of life. But right now, I'm working on a scientific idea of developing a liquid cornea. And liquid cornea is the concept I have been developing for many years, for 5 years now. So that work, the actual experimental work is going on, and related to that, I'm sure in future you will see publications from us.
That's very inspiring to learn that you are doing so much despite being in transition.
That's it. Yeah. That work has to go on.
So the next question is, how did you manage to devote time to your research activities despite being very busy with clinical and administrative duties?
Okay, let me put this in context. Maybe many people don't know what do you mean by busy clinician. I, since March 1998 in LVP, I would see about 100-120 patients twice a week and do 15 to 20 surgery twice a week. And I will also be doing a lot of administrative from day one as in charge of the computers, the technology department, the maintenance department, and several others during my time. But I think if you are interested and passionate about, you really don't need time. And I looked at time in that sense. So being busy and being more productive both go hand in hand. If you are someone thinking that, oh, we'll get time to write papers, we'll sit and think about it, then that's not going to happen. That doesn't happen with anyone.
So I think essentially the message is that time is not a constraint. Don't look at time.
It's not a constraint. It's a invisible mental constraint.
That's a good way of putting it. The next question is a little bit similar. So how did you maintain a work-life balance with so much going on? So a lot of us are also doing not so much, little bit less, but still find it hard to, you know, reconcile with family needs.
Yeah, but see, this is always a challenge in any busy professional. And and balance also, you cannot look at the balance on daily basis. So balance has to be looked at a certain length of time. Say, for example, when my kids were young, if they had a parent-teacher meeting or if they had an important game coming, I would not miss it. So very important events of the family, I would not miss. I would make sure that at least 2 to 3 times in a month we'll go out together for a dinner or a movie or some activity together. And this was despite I had a very, very hectic travel for in last 21, 22 years, at least 6 to 7 trips overseas and similar 5 to 6 trips within India every month. So being effective depends how easily you work with others, how you see value in others. So my way of functioning has been to work with others effectively, develop them, and make them also proud of what they are doing.
So essentially, time was never a constraint for you.
Time is again, it's a mental thing. That people mentally think that they don't have time. And when they think don't have time, obviously you won't have time because mind is busy telling you, I don't have time, I'm too busy. And thinking that only you get tired.
So I think a lot of people look at, lofty achievers, say you are in that bracket. So, you know, how do you manage to put so many things in one day? You know, I think most of our listeners would want to sort of understand something a little more than, how did you sort of, did you use a planner or, anything objective that people can adopt? Or it's just in your mind, the calculations are happening effortlessly?
No, see, the professional commitments, yes, is helpful. Otherwise, you forget. If you have an assistant or a secretary, or you note down in your planner or appointment diary or some sort of those things will help. And then I think it is the mindset. Take the things as they come. And prioritize in my mind, priority is like family is first. My health is first. So these two issues cannot be compromised at any cost. For example, when I joined LVP, initially I was not writing much. I was doing stem cell work and there was a lot of pressure on me. He's not writing. I clearly said that unless I have my own data, unless my own experience, I'm not going to write just for the heck of writing. I will write only when I have enough. So some said, oh, well, here it's an academic environment. I don't care if I don't get promotion, it's okay. If I get less money, it's fine. But I'm not going to kill myself just because everybody else wants me to publish. I'll publish when I think I'm convinced and I have enough data of my own, which needs to be published because it is conveyed something. Just publishing something for the sake of publishing is not a great idea either. It has to add some value. It has to have some teaching value.
And the last question is, any special message to the young researchers who are listening to us? Anything you want to, you want to see happen? Or
I think those of you who are relatively younger in the career, I advise you pay attention to yourself first. Yourself means you, the person who you are. So pay attention to yourself, love yourself. Unless if you don't love yourself, you can't love your family or anybody around you. So you should be in love with yourself. Exercise. I don't mean, I did not do it for many, many years. I started doing only last 3-4 years. And now I'm very much more happier than before. And secondly, contributing scientifically is a natural human nature. If you do it, it will come easily. If you don't do it, you'll be more dukhi. Treating patient, doing surgeries is a vocation that we do. But out of that, there may be many things that you have observed. You think that you should be sharing. Some people should be doing it or not doing it. And that's what the research is. It's not something very exotic. And sometimes, clinical trials come to you. So just take them because it's also a very great learning experience. I mean, I never trained in clinical trials, but 98, the moment I came back, somebody approached me to do a clinical trial and I got into it. I said, I don't know how to do it. He said, we'll teach you. And on the process, learned, and so many clinical trials I have done now that I understand clinical trial business very well from every point of view. If you look at my CV or if you look at the diversity of the work that I have did, I simply, whatever I do, I feel if I'm doing something, other people should also learn. And if I'm doing something different, people should know about it. I would like to share it. Most people think that it's a new idea. I should not get out. I should, patent it. Those things will not get you far. Patenting is okay if it is relevant, if it serves any purpose. If you think it's not going to serve much purpose, then why to waste time in doing those things? Rather share with everyone else if it's helpful. So share, collaborate, and develop others around you.
I think that's a very powerful message that we'll send out from this this conversation that we had. Thank you so much for taking time out and being with us and sharing so much insights into everything that, to so many things that made you who you are. And I hope a lot of these listeners will take a lot of heart and forge ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Sabyasachi. Thank you very much.